Namo namaha, and welcome back. So now that we've learned our first noun paradigms of the Sanskrit language, let's take a look at how each of these seven Sanskrit cases and the three vachanas are going to actually be used, what they actually end up meaning. In this segment, we'll look at the first three cases, the nominative, accusative, and instrumental, along with that eighth quasi-case, the sambodhana or vocative. And then we'll handle the rest in our next segment. The first case, the prathama vibhakti, is known as the nominative in English, and it'll function as the subject of whatever active verb you have in the sentence. In our a stem, if we have our masculine word gajaha, meaning elephant, the nominative forms of this noun, gajaha, are going to be gajaha, one elephant, gajo, two elephants, and gajaha, three or more elephants. For neuter words, let's take the word palam, which means fruit. We're going to get one palam, one fruit, pale, two fruits, and palani, three or more fruits. For feminine words ending in a, let's take kanya, girl. We'll get kanya, one girl, kanye, two girls, and kanyaha, three or more girls. There's one big rule that we should keep in mind right away when it comes to Sanskrit sentences, and we can call it subject-verb agreement. The conjugated verb, whatever it is going to have to agree in number with the subject of the sentence, whatever is in the nominative or prathama vibhakti. So if we're saying the elephant goes, we would say gajaha gachati. If we had two elephants who go, it would be gajau. Now the verb is going to have to change to a dual ending, a third person ending, gachataha, gajau gachataha. If we had many, three or more elephants who are going, it'll become gajaha gachanti. As you're going to learn soon enough, gachanti, the anti, is the third person plural ending of to go. The gender of the subject doesn't matter in terms of agreement. The number is what matters. So if we had a fruit is there, we would say palam tatra asti. If there's two fruit over there, we would say pale tatra staha. Staha is a dual third person of our verb us, meaning to be. If there are many fruits over there, it will be palani tatra santi. Santi is the third person plural of us to be. Similarly, kanya asti tatra, the girl is there, kanye staha tatra, the two girls are there, kanyaha santi tatra, there are many girls there. So that's the first case, the nominative, the prathama vibhakti. We can also here mention the sambodhana, the vocative, and how it works. Again, it's not considered to be a proper case, a kind of quasi-case, because the word that's going to be placed in the vocative doesn't really have a relationship to the verb in the sentence, or actually any other words in the sentence. It's kind of just like a call out to a person or a thing that's being named by your noun. So it's going to look just like the nominative, except for in its singular form, it's going to be different. For a stems, the singular will drop the visarga in the masculine, and it'll drop the final M in the neuter. In the feminine, the long ah will turn into the ekara. So if we wanted to talk to an elephant, we would say, he gajau. If we wanted to talk to two elephants, he gajau. Or three or more elephants, he gajaha. Right? The same way with our fruit. If we wanted to talk to a fruit, he pala. He pale, two fruits. He palani, three or more fruits. With a girl, hey girl, he kanye. Hey, two girls, also, hey, kanye, right? It can mean either one. And also, hey, kanyaha would mean, hey, three or more girls. The second case, the dvitiya vibhakti, our accusative case, this we'll use when our noun is going to be the direct object of a verb. The thing that the verb happens to, the thing that gets eaten, the thing that gets given, the thing that gets said, the thing that gets praised, and so on, the person who gets praised. For our masculine word gajaha, the accusative of this would be gajam, gajau, gajan. One elephant is the object of the verb, two elephants, or three or more elephants are the object of the verb. Neuter word phalam, the dvitiya vibhakti will be phalam, pale, palani. One fruit, two fruits, three or more fruits that are the object of the verb. Notice that it's exactly the same as the pratama, the nominative case. This is going to be a situation you'll find for all, basically all, napumsaka neuter words. The first and second case will be the same. First, strilinga, the feminine word kanya. We'll get in the accusative, it'll become kanyam, kanye, kanyaha. Another thing to notice here is that the dual and plural forms are identical in the nominative and accusative. This is a recurring feature of feminine noun stems. The other thing to notice in all of these so far for accusative is that there's an M that ends the accusative singular forms. Gajam, palam, kanyam. This M is actually a very, very old accusative affix. It goes all the way back into Proto-Indo-European. We can even see remnants of this ancient M in English in the words him, right, or them, or even in the word whom. Just a little fun fact for you. Now, the usage of the accusative dvitiya vibhakti is fairly straightforward. It's going to be the object of any action of the verb. Gajaha palam khadati would mean the elephant eats one fruit. Kanya pale khadati would mean one girl eats two fruits. Ramaha palani khadati would mean our hero Rama eats many, many fruits, at least three fruits. One thing to be aware of, though, is that verbs of motion are also going to take a direct object in Sanskrit, whereas in English, we usually express it with the preposition to. So in English, you would say the elephant is going to the forest. In Sanskrit, it'll be gajaha vanam gachati, where vanam means the forest, and it's in the second accusative case, dvitiya vibhakti. Kanya gruham gachati, the girl goes home. Ashwaha shalam gachati, the horse goes into the stable. The first one here, vanam, is a neuter word. Second word, grahaha, is a masculine word. And the third word, shala, is a feminine word. They're all in the accusative case here for gachati, to go. Finally, we'll turn to our third case, the tritiya vibhakti, the instrumental. This we can translate as by or with X, by means of X. For masculine gajaha, it'll be gajena, gajabhyam, gajaihi, by the elephant, by the two elephants, by many elephants. For neuter, it'll be the same as the masculine forms, palena, palabhyam, palaihi. For kanya, for our feminine, we'll get kanyaya, right? Kanyabhyam, kanyabhihi. By the one girl, by the two girls, by the three or more girls. The third case is we can find used for two distinct purposes. First, it gets used when the verb is being done by means of something or by means of someone. So if you had the sentence, Ramaha hastena palam khadati, right? It would mean Rama is eating the fruit with his hand. Hasta means hand. This ena ending is your singular third case, hastena, by hand, by his hand. The second meaning of the tritiya vibhakti, the instrument, this instrumental, is of accompaniment. If the subject is doing the action of the verb accompanied by someone else or something else, that someone or something is going to be in the instrumental also. Addition to that, to specify that accompaniment meaning, generally we'll add the word saha alongside it. Saha means along with or accompanied by. So if Ramaha vanam gachati means Rama goes to the forest, you can first of all say Ramaha gajena vanam gachati. This could mean Rama goes to the forest using the elephant, right? By means of riding an elephant, in other words. But if you say Ramaha sitaya saha vanam gachati, you're saying Rama goes to the forest accompanied by Sita. The opposite of saha is vina, and without, and this you can also use this with the instrumental. You can also use it with your second case, the accusative as well. So you could say, Ramaha sitaya vina vanam gachati. Rama is going to the forest without Sita. Gajaha hastena vina palam khadati. The elephant is eating the fruit without using his hands. Or you could say, hastam vina palam khadati as well. You can use the accusative. Another idiomatic usage of the instrumental is with the word alam, which means enough or it's sufficient. When you use it with the tritiya vibhakti, there's an idiomatic meaning like enough of this X, whatever it is. So if you say alam palaihi, you're saying, enough of these fruits, I'm tired of them. Alam pustakena, enough of this book, I'm bored by it, that kind of thing. Finally, the instrumentals can also be used idiomatically with gim, which is our question word that means what. And we'll get, what's the use of X, or what's the point of X? So you could say gim palena, which would mean, what's the point, what's the use of this fruit? What good does this fruit do? Or kim pustakena, what's the point of this book? Kim malaya, what's the use of this necklace? So with that, let's pause here as we continue working on learning to recognize and internalize the meanings of the first three of our vibhaktis. When you feel confident about it, then you can come back and we'll look at the four remaining vibhaktis. Until then, see you next time. Thank you for watching. Punarmilamaha. Vadamaha.